亲爱的腾讯文化网友，大家好，欢迎收看海外异宴。我们今天上午在英国泰特美术馆为大家直播。我们现在非常荣幸地邀请到泰特美术馆维多利亚绘画策展人 Alison Smith 为大家讲解。Good morning, Alison. Thank you very much for giving us the guided tour this morning. Could you tell us a little bit about the collection and the display in this room, please?
Good morning. Well, we're standing in the largest room at Tate Britain, which is given over to works from the Victorian era, the 19th century. It's a very densely hung room, as a room would have been hung in the 19th century, in tiers, with works piled up from floor to ceiling.
Yeah. 所以我们现在是在泰特美术馆的最大的一个展厅里面。那这个展厅全部都是维多利亚时代，也就是19世纪时代的绘画。而且你所看到的这个展厅的陈列方式呢，就是跟在19世纪的画廊所陈列的方式非常的类似。在当时呢，他们在做画展的时候呢，是把绘画是一层一层高高低低的不同的这样子来陈列。
And these works represent a variety of different styles. So we have Pre-Raphaelite works, we have aesthetic and symbolist ones, and impressionist ones and naturalist ones.
Okay. 所以在这个展厅里面呢，我们有不同的风格的作品，像前拉斐尔派的，还有印象派的，然后还有那个象征主义的，还有symbolism and what is the last one?
So naturalist.
还有那个自然主义的画派。Yes. So.
Yeah. And you will see a lot of these paintings represent women, and we're going to be looking at images of women today. So should we look at our first image? If you just look up here,、
yeah.
this is by an artist called Dante Gabriel Rossetti.、
Yeah.你可以看得到，在这个展厅里面呢，有很多很多绘画里面都有女性的角色里面，所以这也是我们今天要讲的主题。所以呢，我们第一幅要讲的作品是那个罗塞提的那个作品。
And the painting is called The Beloved, and this is a quotation from the Song of Songs in the Book of Solomon.
这幅绘画的主题呢，叫做挚爱的，然后这个主题的来源呢，是一首歌叫做《所罗门之歌》的歌词里面来的。
And you will see it's arranged like a European religious icon or religious painting, but instead of it being a holy personage in the center, it represents a beautiful woman surrounded by attendants.
所以你可以看得到，在绘画里面呢，它的那个构图有点像，中古世纪的宗教绘画通常是一个神像，但是呢，他用女性来取代了神的地位，神像的位置。
And the idea is the women are looking out towards the bridegroom. So the idea is the groom worships the image as he would a religious icon.
所以呢，这群女人呢，她们是看着中间的这位新娘，然后就像在那个宗教绘画里面呢，通常是一位神，然后旁边站了一群天使。
So it's about the worship of female beauty.
所以这个就是赞颂女性的美。
And in the painting, you have the woman with auburn hair in the center, and she's surrounded on the outside by women who are darker skinned and have darker hair. And in the foreground is a little black girl. So in a sense, he's implying some kind of racial hierarchy.
所以呢，在这幅画里面，最中间这位女性呢，她的肤色呢是最洁白的，然后在。他后面所站的几位女士呢，她们的肤色就比较不一样，然后在前面呢又是一个非洲来的小女孩的那个画像，所以她所代表的是整个不同的种族的女性的美。
But on the other hand, it's also about transculturalism, because the woman in the center, even though she's European, she's wearing a kimono on her.Head. She wears a Chinese hair ornament. The little girl in the foreground is wearing an African ornament.
所以这幅画呢，所讲的也是一个就是不同的文化的探讨不同文化的绘画。比方说，像这个中间的这位女性呢，她头上所戴的其实是一个像中国式的法式，然后她的衣服呢的布料有点像日本和服，然后前面的。 女孩子呢，她是一个来自非洲的女孩子。
So really, it's about beauty being a transnational and a transcultural ideal across nations.
所以它所代表的是美呢，不仅仅是只有欧洲，或者是不限于任何的国界，是全球的，而且是不分不同的文化，是到处都可以找得到美的。
And Rossetti wanted the image to appear as luscious and beautiful as possible, hence the lovely rich deep greens and intense oranges and the sort of the voluptuous appearance of the women.
所以那个艺术家呢，他希望这个绘画呢颜色要更加的亮丽一点，所以他所采用的颜色呢也都非常非常的强烈，像绿色的袍子，然后很红，大红的花。
And the idea is you just want to look at the image and indulge in its beauty and worship it.
所以呢，你就是让你可以看这个美丽的花，然后几乎可以这样子崇拜这个美丽的女人，还有美。
So could you tell us the next painting, please?
So these two paintings here are part of a triptych, i.e. three paintings.
所以下面这两幅作品呢，其实它是三幅作品其中的两幅。
And the triptych was titled Woman's Mission.
所以这三幅画的那个标题呢是女性的任务。
It's by an artist called George Elgar Hicks, and we think the model of the woman who appears in all three paintings, of which one is missing, was his own wife. 啊，
然后这幅作品的那个艺术家呢，叫做那个希克斯。然后呢，这三幅作品呢，虽然其中有一幅已经不见了，但是其中那个女主角呢，其实就是艺术家自己本身的太太。
In the first painting, it's called Woman's Mission, Guide of Childhood, and it shows a woman walking with a young child.
所以第一幅作品呢是一个女性，然后带着她的小女儿，但是那幅作品已经不在了。
The middle painting is this one here called Companion of Manhood, and what you see in this painting is the man, obviously her husband. He has received bad news. We know it's bad news because the envelope has black edging and the letter has a thick black line around it, which implies a death.
Yeah.
So, 所以这幅作品呢，这个是叫做女性的任务，然后她要安慰她的丈夫，因为她故事里面讲了，她丈夫呢可能已经收到一个很不幸的消息了，因为你可以看得到她在那个地上的那个有一个信封呢，它上面有那个黑色的线条，那表示说呢，这是一个很不幸的消息，而且他的他手上所握的信呢，上面也有那个黑的线条。
And you will see they're structured like a triangle. The man is in the upright position, and that would tend to imply that he is the pater familias, he's the strong person, and she is leaning on him, she is the weaker one.
然后呢，这个绘画的构图呢，你可以看得到，它是一个三角形的构图。然后在三角形的最顶端呢是男的，所以他是一个最主要的人物，最有权威的人物。然后女性呢，她是依着他，表示说她是比较脆弱的，比较软弱的那个角色。
But the artist has slightly subverted that idea because he has his hand over his face. He's in a moment of vulnerability, and she is supporting him. So the woman is the center, the strong.Point in the home. That's the idea. I think he's trying to convey.
Yeah. 所以呢，在这个构图里面，虽然男性呢他是站在最主要的角色，但是呢，他把手呢是遮在脸部上面的，所以呢，他的那个他是在一个非常脆弱的那个感情非常脆弱的情况下，然后其实是他的太太，虽然是站在他的下面，但是是他太太支撑着他。所以说，这个艺术家他所想要代表的呢，也是把反过来把这个家庭的结构呢，男性在上面，女生在下面，稍微的那个转变。
And this idea is continued in the last painting in the series when you show the same woman offering a sort of hot drink or victual to an elderly man who is presumably her father.
然后呢，在这另外一幅呢，是这三幅画的最后一幅画，你可以看得到，这个可能是这个她丈夫的父亲，可能是她的丈 岳父，然后呢，他已经生病了，所以他的太太呢，在照顾这个老年人。
And you can see how he's sort of lifting up his feeble hand to receive the glass, and she's leaning over to tend to him. So again, it's the idea the woman is the center of the home, upon which the stability and health of the family depends.
所以呢，这也代表了，因为你可以看得到他已经很老了，而且没有什么精力，所以他呢便要这个女人呢来照顾这个老人，而且他。给他吃药，所以这个代表说女性呢，在家庭里面呢，其实是家庭的中枢。
Should we move on and look at another painting?
那我们接下来再看下一幅作品。
So this painting here by John William Waterhouse, The Lady of Shalott, is one of the most popular paintings in the Tate Collection.
所以我们现在所看到的这幅作品呢，是那个 Waterhouse 所画的那个夏洛特姑娘。那这幅画呢，是泰特美术馆里面呢最受欢迎的绘画之一。
And it's based on a very famous poem by Tennyson called The Lady of Shalott.
所以这个是从那个丹尼森一个英国浪漫诗人呢所写的一首诗叫做夏洛特姑娘所改编的一幅画。
And this poem tells of a lady who's condemned by a curse to live apart from the world in a tower.
所以呢在这个故事里面呢夏洛特姑娘因为受到诅咒所以必须要被关在一个高塔里面。
She's not allowed to look at the outside world except from what she sees reflected in a magic mirror.
但是呢，她没有办法直接往外看，她只能透过镜子，然后看到镜子上面的反射，看到外面的世界。
And through looking in the mirror, she weaves on her loom the sights reflected in the mirror. And this is implied in the painting by her embroidery. These roundels here represent scenes she has seen in her mirror.
所以她在高塔的时候呢，她就会看到从镜子里面所看到的，然后把它用编织的方式呢编织在那个毯子里面。所以你现在在毯子上面看到的这一幅一幅的景象，都是她透过镜子所看到外面的真实的世界。
And the poem describes how one day she sees reflected in the mirror the gallant Sir Lancelot galloping on his way to Camelot. He's so ravishing and beautiful that she actually looks outside, and the curse falls upon her.
Okay, 那有一天呢，她正在看她的镜子的时候呢，她看到有一个非常非常英俊的骑士，他就是兰斯洛骑士。然后他刚好从那个塔外面呢，骑马过去。他从镜子里面看到这个骑士长得非常的英俊，他立刻爱上了这个马，爱上了这个骑士。所以呢，他情不自禁的呢，就直接往外看。然后他的诅咒就应验了。
And Waterhouse captures the final moment in the poem where she leaves the tower, enters a boat, and drifts down to Camelot. When she arrives, they find her dead.、
所以呢，这个艺术家呢，他就是把这首诗最后的一段呢，把它改编成这幅画。所以呢，夏洛特姑娘为了追求她的爱人，所以她决定要离开这个高塔，然后。搭船到他爱人所住的那个城堡，所以呢，这个他就搭着船，然后终于到城堡的时候，但是到了城堡的时候，他已经过世了。
This painting was influenced by an earlier work by John Everett Millais called Ophelia, which we'll be looking at in a moment.
那这幅作品呢，是受到一幅比较早一点完成的作品，是另外一个艺术家叫米莱所做的奥菲利亚的作品。那等一下我们会跟大家介绍奥菲利亚这件作品。
And the points of connection are the wreaths in the foreground and the lady herself, who has her lips apart in this sort of expression of supplication or sexual ecstasy.
所以呢，我们要大家记住的是，你看到这个前面的这个芦苇。还有这个夏洛特姑娘，她脸上的表情，她半张的这个嘴唇，几乎是一种狂喜的一种姿态里面。然后等一下我们讲到那个奥菲利亚的时候呢，我要希望大家可以记住这两个最主要的动机。
But it's painted in a much broader impressionist technique, so you can see each brushwork how it's applied to the canvas, and of course much larger in scale. And he's using this new French-inspired modern technique, but applying it to a traditional Pre-Raphaelite subject in order to bring out the sort of supernatural, her height.And trance-like state of mind, which of course accords with the whole contemporary interest in psychoanalysis.
Oh, okay. So, 呢，我们可以看到他这个 所画的笔触呢比较比较粗犷，所以你可以看到一笔一笔的所画的线条在上面。但是如果跟前拉斐尔派来比较的话，前拉斐尔派画得非常的精细，你几乎可以看不到他任何的笔触。他这个笔触会这么粗犷呢，是因为受到19世纪晚期法国印象派艺术家的影响。在那时候他们希望很快的捕捉大自然，所以他们的那个笔触都非常非常的快捷。然后呢，这幅作品呢当然也是非常非常的跟夏洛特姑娘跟奥菲利亚比起来呢，也大很多。然后呢，还有她脸上这个表情，这种好像在半睡半醒这种表情呢，在当时19世纪末期非常盛行，是对psychoanalysis 是对那个心理分析非常的，大家对心理分析这个学科非常的好奇，所以呢，艺术家在画这个的时候，可能也是受到心理学家这种分析的那个影响。
And this sort of fairy tales of ethereal representation of the woman, of the lady, has been very influential, not just in painting, but also in fashion. And so you will see in the 20th century, in the 1970s, for example, you had a revival of this type of dress, women going around with long hair and flowing robes, sort of hippie look, very much looking back to Waterhouse, and through Waterhouse back to the Pre-Raphaelites.
那像她身上所穿的衣服呢，像她头上所戴的那个头箍，还有他的衣服，这种非常浪漫的方式呢，其实在后来呢，也是有对那个时装设计也有很大的影响。尤其是在70年代的时候，你可以看到很多女性呢，她们那时候挑选所穿的衣服呢，都很接近像这个夏洛特姑娘所穿的，上头上所戴的头箍，还有她的衣服。然后呢，这个其实是这个艺术家 Waterhouse 呢，他受到 Waterhouse 的影响，但是 Waterhouse 他所受的影响是更早以前，也就是在19世纪大概中期的时候，前拉斐尔画派艺术家的影响。
Let's look at another painting. We just come here, and on the top register is a painting by Albert Moore, Blossoms.
Yeah. 所以我们现在接下来看的一幅画呢，是一位艺术家叫做 Albert Moore 摩尔所画的。然后呢，他的那个主题就叫做盛开。
Lot of the artists associated with the ascetic movement were also exponents of ascetic dress. This was part of the dress reform movement of the 19th century.
然后在19世纪的时候，很多艺术家呢，非常追求这种唯美的主义的唯美主义，所以呢，他所做的唯美主义不仅仅是唯美的绘画，还有唯美的他们的那个服装。
They look back to antiquity, to the classical period, also to China and to Japan, where they thought wearing loose flowing robes was healthier, in that women were not all trussed up in corsets, which were damaging for the health. They thought these loose flowing robes were about a healthy body, and so it's really trying to revive the Greek idea of a healthy mind, a healthy body.
Okay. 所以呢，在当时呢，他们认为说，他们就是去参考希腊，还有甚至是中国，还有日本的和服的这种穿戴的方式，因为在那个时候呢，那个衣服就比较宽松。然后大家都知道，在维多利亚时代，大家在当时的女性呢，必须要穿那个紧身衣。但是呢，在19世纪，这些追求唯美主义的艺术家人认为，还有当时的社会开始觉得说紧身衣对身体不健康，因为太紧了。所以如果你穿的是希腊罗马这样子宽松的袍子的话，对身体会健康，会有益身体健康。而且呢，最重要的是，如果你身体健康的话，你的心理也会健康，所以是身心健全。
And so this painting is really about looking at beauty as a sort of abstract ideal. So the painting is composed in these very delicate tonal harmonies of salmon pink, red, brown, delicate whites. And the idea is they all fuse on your retina like a pattern.
所以这幅画呢，几乎就是讨论美，就是它像它所用的颜色，像那个三文鱼的那种那个粉红色，还有它背后的白色，还有前面 地毯的红色，其实呢，它就是让你的眼睛看起来就是非常的柔和，非常的美。所以它最主要的原因就是要呈现一幅最美的景象。
And the artist is again combining different cultural elements. So you have the contrapposto and serpentina curve associated with Gothic art, yet the decorative patterning associated with Japanese art. So looking outside of Europe to try and formulate a new ideal of beauty, which really was in opposition to what a lot of these artists derided as sort of, you know, bourgeoisie bad taste.
所以呢，你可以看到这个女性的姿势，她所站的这种那个 contrapposto 是在歌德是中古世纪的雕塑里面常常可以看到，就是所谓的 contrapposto， 就是她一只脚有点向前伸，然后甚至往另外一边倾斜，这个这样子的姿势可以在很多的欧洲的雕塑里面看得到，所以这是纯欧洲的。但是呢，如果你在看画的背后，它上面的那个花朵，还有它的那个构造呢，是结构呢，是非常受到日本绘画的影响。那也表示说，这个艺术家他是融合了不同的文化，然后打开整个欧洲的狭隘的视野，所以他也是一个比较有世界观的艺术家。
And you'll also see the format of the painting. It's like a stained glass mirror, stained glass window, or like a sort of Japanese scroll. It's sort of, you know, long and vertical. And it's, again, it's looking to non-European art for inspiration.
还有这个画的那个形状呢，有点像在教堂里面的那个彩绘玻璃的大小，但是呢，它又有点像那个中国或者是日本的卷轴，所以呢，他已经跳出这个整个欧洲的传统，然后进入这个东方的绘画的方式。
Should we look at something completely different?
Yes, please. Yeah. 所以我们接下来往再继续往前走，然后看另外一个艺术家的作品。
And I'm going to show you a work by an artist called Stanhope Forbes, who worked in a rural community on Newlyn in Cornwall.
然后我们接下来所看的呢是这幅作品呢是一位艺术家，他的名字叫做霍布斯，然后呢他不是在那个伦敦作画，他是到一个很小的很小的渔村，叫做在坑瓦尔的一个很小的渔村叫做 Newlyn 所作画的。
And you'll see this is very different from the Albert Moore painting we've been looking at, which is just about art and beauty and formal values. This is at, has a subject at its center, which is a village wedding.
那这幅画跟前一幅画呢？不同的地方是它不是讲这种唯美的，它其实它这个是讲一个故事，然后这个故事呢就是在那个乡村里面的婚礼，你可以看到这中间有一个新娘在里面。
And in this painting you see different generations of a family, elderly people, grandparents, the bride and groom, young children all brought together and they're toasting the bride. It's called the health of the bride.
所以呢在这幅画里面你可以看到不同年纪不同阶层的人呢，大家坐在一桌，然后像有老爷爷，有小孩子，还有其他的中年或者是比较年轻人，然后大家呢都是向这个新娘呢敬酒，就是希望她祝她身体健康。
It's a beautiful piece of painting. It's very, the light is very dim, but you have light shining in from outside, and you can see the fishing boats in the distance, which tells you it's a fishing community. And the light falls on the table and illuminates the whiteness of her wedding dress, and of course the white wedding cake.
所以呢，虽然这个画面呢非常的暗，因为这个室内很暗，但是你可以看到窗外有光线进来，而且你可以看到外面呢有渔船，表示说这个是在一个渔村画的，然后这个光线照进来的时候，可以就是反射到白色的餐桌，还有那个新娘的白色的那个新娘的服装，还有最重要就是桌子最中央的这个结婚蛋糕。
And the painting is composed as if the artist is capturing a spontaneous moment when they're about to make the toast. So it's the influence of photography comes to bear on this painting.
所以这幅画呢，几乎就是非常及时的在就是他们刚刚要站起来跟新娘举杯祝贺的时候的那一刹那，所以呢，艺术家他所捕捉的就是那一刹那，在这样子的构图方式呢，几乎呢就是像拍摄 摄影的方式很接近。
And it's beautifully observed the way the different people are.Responding to the scene, so the bride looks very bashful. She's very self-conscious that she's the centre of attention, and you will see other members of the group are sort of holding their glasses very carefully. On the wall in the top left, you can't see it, is a temperance poster. Temperance was a movement warning people against the evil effects of alcohol. So this is a family who are not used to drinking alcohol, so they're holding their glasses very carefully because it's a very special moment.
Okay, 所以如果你可以那个仔细的看每个人脸上的表情呢，都非常的不一样。像因为这个新娘子，因为她是大家关注的重心，所以她非常的谨慎，而且她有点甜面。但是呢，其他的你如果看其他的人呢，他们在握酒杯的样子呢，都非常非常小心的小心的握酒杯，好像怕酒杯会碎掉或怎么样子。那这个原因是因为，如果你看到在左上角有一幅画，现在在画面上看不太清楚，但是左上角这幅画呢，他所画的那个角色就是Temperance 是一个女神，她所代表的就是情绪的和谐，也就是说不需要不可以太过度的去情绪的激动，然后他也另外是讲说不要喝酒，所以呢你可以看得出这个渔村的人民呢，他们是不太习惯喝酒的人。
I should also mention this is one of the first representations of a woman wearing a white wedding dress. We are now used to brides wearing white. This was a custom which was gradually introduced in the course of the 19th century.
还有呢，这幅画里面呢，新娘所穿的那个白色的新娘礼服呢，这是第一次在绘画里面看到新娘穿白色的新娘礼服，而且或者是最早看到有穿白色的新娘礼服。因为呢，在过去新娘结婚的时候，在欧洲他们不是穿白色的，是到19世纪的时候才渐渐开始有人建议说新娘必须要穿白色的新娘礼服，所以在这幅画里面是第一次看得到新娘穿白色的新娘礼服的。
Should we go and look at another painting?
Yes, thank you.
然后我们接下来再看其他的作品。
So if we walk up here, again these are painted of portraits, street scenes. We're now going to look at another Pre-Raphaelite painting, I think.This one here?
Yes.
所以我们接下来这样子走过来的时候呢，可以看到有不同的题材的作品，像肖像画，还有landscape， 像那个市景，还有夜景的绘画。那接下来呢，我们要看的是另外一幅作品，它是前拉斐尔派的绘画。
This is a painting by Arthur Hughes called April Love, and it's one of the most popular Pre-Raphaelite works in our collection.
那他这幅作品叫做《四月情》，是一个艺术家叫做那个亚瑟修斯所画的，然后这也是在美术馆里面最受欢迎的一幅画。
And it was very loosely based on a poem called The Miller's Daughter by Tennyson. Tennyson was very popular with these artists.
然后呢，这幅画呢是根据一位诗人，也是我们刚才讲的夏洛特姑娘的那个诗人叫丁尼森。然后丁尼森的一首诗叫做模仿主的女儿所改编的一幅画。
And the artist is making the connection between the April season, early spring, and the fragile nature of young love.
然后艺术家呢把这个春天四月的这个季节呢，还有年轻人之间的爱情的脆弱来做比较。
So in the foreground, you have a woman with a rather distraught expression on her face, turning away from a young man who's clasping her hand, and the implication is perhaps she's rejecting him. So here you have the woman making the decision in deciding to reject her suitor.
然后在这幅画里面。你可以看到这个女性的表情，她好像不是很高兴的表情，好像她在生气一样。然后你可以在后面看到这个男的，他把双手握在双手盖在他的脸上，我们可以 可以猜测，可能呢，这个女的呢，她拒绝了这个她的男朋友。
In the 19th century, artists would often draw a connection between natural forms and human relationships. So usually the oak tree was seen to stand for the strong, sturdy man, and the clingy ivy for the dependent woman. But the artist is playing around that with that idea in this painting by having the sort of the woman.Moving away from the man.
在十九世纪，艺术家经常用植物来象征不同的意义，像中间这个树木呢，表示就是很强壮的，可以支撑的。然后在旁边的这个常春藤呢，是依赖性的。然后但是呢，在这幅画里面，艺术家把这个男性跟女性的角色呢，把它相反了，所以女性呢变成是站着，然后男的呢变成他是。在一个非常沮丧的一个情况之下，所以呢，这也是艺术家他所玩的这种那个象征的手法。
Should we look at another painting?
Yes.
So if we come here, we will now look at probably the most famous Pre-Raphaelite painting in our collection, which is Millet's Ophelia, which is the work we're looking at now.
然后接下来我们要看到的是，几乎是吸引了全世界人到泰特美术馆的最重要的原因，就是这个米莱的《奥菲利亚》这幅作品。
And this is based on the scene in Shakespeare's Hamlet, when Ophelia, distraught at the news of the death of her father, becomes slightly deranged and falls to her muddy death by slipping into a stream and being dragged down by the weight of her garments under the surface of the water.
然后这个故事是来自莎士比亚的《哈姆雷特》。在哈姆雷特里面呢，奥菲利亚是哈姆雷特的女朋友，但是呢，哈姆雷特不小心把那个奥菲利亚的父亲呢刺杀了，然后他听到父亲的死亡呢，非常的伤心，然后那时候当时有点精神错乱，结果就投入这个湖里面，然后因为他穿的衣服非常的重，所以他就渐渐的沉在湖里面，然后就这样子淹死了。
It's a very unusual representation of her death because the great attention within this natural setting has been focused on the expression of Ophelia, her slightly glazed eyes, her open mouth. She's like a figure, a saint in ecstasy, but it also could be a moment of sort of, you know, sexual ecstasy as well. It's very ambiguous, and her hands are sort of parted as if receiving her fate.
然后在一般有关奥菲利亚的绘画里面呢，这幅画非常非常的特别。为什么呢？因为你看这个周遭的这些植物呢，都是为了要环绕的中间这个最重要的女主角。然后奥菲利亚，如果你看到她的脸部的表情，她的嘴巴是半张的，然后她的眼睛呢，像玻璃球这样子，几乎就是已经没有生命了。然后她的手又往两边撑开，有点像在宗教仪式的时候，有时候是在基督教宗教仪式的时候，你受到很狂乱的这种那个宗教的感激的时候，会有这样子的表情，但是也有可能是他是在一个非常激动、非常爱情的激动之下所产生的一个表情，所以这是很不寻常的。
And the success of this painting was not just down to Millet's skill as an artist, because it's beautifully painted, but also to the model who posed for the figure of Ophelia. This was a young woman who was discovered by the Pre-Raphaelites called Elizabeth Siddal.
然后这幅画呢，为什么会这么受欢迎呢？不仅仅是因为这个艺术家他的技巧非常的好，而且还是这幅画里面的这个女主角呢，她的模特儿是前拉斐尔派的艺术家们共同发现的一位模特儿，她的名字叫做伊丽莎白西戴尔。
Siddal was not only an artist in her own right, but she was also brilliant in taking on a role and in acting it. So with Ophelia, for example, Millet asked her to sit, or got her to sit, to lie down in a bathtub in his studio, and he had the water heated from underneath. And she was so sort of dedicated to her role that even when the heating failed and the water went cold, she did not move. She became very ill as a result. But she was so intent on sort of capturing the plight of Ophelia.
那这位模特儿呢 ，Elizabeth Seidel， 她自己本身也是一个艺术家，然后所以她自己在做模特的时候，她也非常的进入情况，所以为了要画这幅画的时候呢，艺术家请她呢，她在她的工作室里面做了一个浴缸，然后在浴缸下面呢，烧用蜡烛来那个。保持水温的那个水温，所以它不会太冷。但是呢，有时候蜡烛已经燃烧完了，然后水也变冷了。但是这个模特儿，他为了要让艺术家持续的画，他也持续的就躺在水里面。然后因为水变得很冷，所以他为了这幅画还患了重病，差点丧生。
So it's really her sort of skill in taking on this role, which really made this painting a big success. So when you look at this painting today, people always approach it in two ways. On the one hand, they see it as the drowning Ophelia, but they also see it as Elizabeth Siddal lying in the bathtub. They see it as both Ophelia and as Elizabeth Siddal in the role of Ophelia.
所以因为这个模特儿她自己本身的个性呢，所以现在大家看这幅画的时候呢，大家可以看到有两个不同的层面，其中一个是奥菲利亚在湖上，然后另外一个是 Elizabeth Siddal 这个模特儿她躺在这个浴缸里面被绘画，所以你可以看得到，同时有两个角色，一个是奥菲利亚，另外一个就是 Elizabeth Siddal。
And when this painting was first exhibited, people really responded to it. And Millais was admired as an artist who could really paint women. He could understand their minds, their thoughts, their emotions. And this helped establish his popular success.
然后这幅画呢，在第一次展出的时候呢，在非常的轰动，因为大家知道说这个
Annie Miller. Annie Miller was a working class girl who was illiterate. Hunt wanted to marry her, educate her, and improve her. Ultimately, she rejected him. She wanted to leave her own life. She didn't want to be improved. But this painting was produced at the time when Hunt had hopes for her future.
Okay. 然后这幅画的灵感呢，是艺术家亨特呢，他在当时呢有一个情妇，然后这个情妇呢，她不识字，然后但是她很爱他，他希望呢这个教导他识字，让他如何来进入一个社会的大家可以尊敬的人物。然后呢，但是这个女的呢，她虽然艺术家很努力的想要教育她，但是她还是拒绝了她的要求，所以决定要离开。
The subject is a modern moral subject, and it shows us how you have this woman in her nightdress. The idea is that she's a kept woman, she's a courtesan.
然后这个其实是一个道德的故事。然后这个女孩子呢，她所穿的衣服呢，应该算是那个晚上的的袍子，应该我们在讲说是像夜衣这样子的，然后所以表示说他不是结婚，他不是他的太太，他是一个被人家养的情妇。
And the scene is set in a fashionable modern villa, and her sort of lover is playing some music on the piano. And I think the idea the artist is trying to convey is that the music stirs memories in her, which causes her to rise up from his lap and to look out at the window, which is reflected.In the mirror behind.
所以呢，在这个室内呢，是一个非常传统的、相当富裕的室内。然后，画中的男主角呢，他在弹钢琴，然后在唱歌。然后呢，故事的背景是因为这个音乐呢，激发了这个女性的一种情感，决定要立刻从这个她的腿上站起来，然后望向窗外。所以她所对我们所看的，其实她是看到窗外，因为如果你看她这个背后的这个镜子呢，她所反射的就是她所看出去的东西。
And the light coming into the room, which you see here and reflected through the mirror, stands for the light of her conscience. So it's about her moment of transformation. Will she be saved from this sinful life?Or will she not?
然后，如果您看这个角落的这个光线呢，这个是因为窗子是在这个他所看到的，就是我们所站的背后，所以光线这样子照过来的时候，就是 点到这个角落，所以呢，这个也是艺术家的象征，说他是不是这个光，是不是一灿光明，他是不是可以有因为有良心的觉醒，然后到最后可以被赎罪。
And like a sort of contemporary novel, it's left at this sort of cliffhanger moment. So certain details, such as the cat about to claw the bird, that these they stand for the man and woman respectively. And the idea is, will she escape or won't she?
然后呢，这幅画呢，就有点像那个当现代的那种侦探小说那种非常紧张的情节。比方说，如果你可以看这个下面有一只猫，然后它正要抓这只鸟，那就又有点像说这个鸟是不是可以逃得过猫？所以呢，它有点像这个男的是不是可以，这个女孩子是不是可以逃离这个男性的捕捉？
So the artist is trying to intervene in a whole big social debate about prostitution in contemporary society. And I think he's trying to argue that fallen women can be saved, but the saving often comes through the light of religion. Hunt was a very religious man. He had a religious conversion around this time. Mm-hmm. And so in painting this sort of secular, modern-day subject, he's sort of trying to imply through...this realist approach that realism can actually be a modern form of religious art in that the light element stands in for redemption.
Okay. Yeah, 艺术家呢，他是因为他自己本身是非常虔诚的，所以他想透过这幅作品呢，来探讨这个就是堕落的女性呢，是不是可以透过宗教来赎罪？所以呢，他虽然所用的整个，他不是在一个教堂里面，也完全没有看到有任何的基督教的符号在里面，但是他所用的呢，是这个右下角的这道光来代表这个宗教的力量。他想知道说，是不是可以用到宗教的力量，让堕落的女性呢有机会来赎罪，来还原。
I should mention that it's very daring for an artist at this time to confront a subject, a sensitive subject such as prostitution in painting, bearing in mind that these paintings would be shown in exhibitions which attracted so-called respectable audiences.
而且呢，在当时呢，艺术家呢画这样子的题材呢是非常大胆的，因为像这样子的画呢，在展览去看的呢，就是一些在社会上非常受到尊敬的人，所以他们看到画里面画的是一个妓女的角色，在对他们来讲呢，可能是一种很大的惊讶，所以呢，艺术家呢他会画这样子的题材也是非常大胆的尝试。
And this is just to make the point that the artists saw themselves as being activists, that art was a potent means of intervening in social, and commenting upon sort of urgent topical social issues and getting people to think.
所以呢，在当时维多利亚时代，有很多艺术家呢，他们自己本身呢也是一个社会工作者，所以他们想透过艺术来传达他们的社会理想。所以呢，这个就是一个其中的一个例子。
And this relates to the painting you see. If we stand back a moment and see the painting above, this was produced by a female artist who was a contemporary of Holman Hunt, called Emily Mary Osborne. It's called Nameless and Friendless.
Okay. 然后呢，如果我们再往上面看一下这上面这幅画呢，这幅画呢是一位艺术家叫做 Emily Osborne 所画的。然后他跟那个下面这幅绘画的作者呢，那个 Holman Hunt 是同一个时代所画的。然后他的画的主题呢叫做 nameless
and friendless，
没有名也没有朋友。
Emily Mary Osborne was one of a group of women at the time who were activists. They were campaigning for female rights, for access to art education, for better education for women in general, for sort of legal representation, the right to own property, the right to divorce.
然后这位艺术家呢，他在当时呢是非常激进的来争取女性的权利，所以呢他希望为女性争取接受艺术教育，接受教育，还有甚至呢，女性有那个投票权，这些不同的女权运动。
And in order to make her point, she paints this very emotional subject, which shows a young woman with her, she's probably an orphan because she's dressed in black, with her younger brother, going into a print seller's shop or an art dealer's, and trying to get persuade the dealer to sell one of her paintings.
然后在这幅作品里面呢，她 他把自己呢画成一个应该是孤儿吧，因为他呢是穿着黑色的衣裳，然后在旁边呢站着是他的那个弟弟，然后他带着他的弟弟呢到伦敦的一家画廊呢，希望呢把他的画呢卖给这个，请这个画廊帮他卖画。
And the dealer is looking at her painting in rather a suspicious way. He's weighing up its merits, perhaps implying he's going to turn her down and she'll be cast back into the streets. And she is contrasted in the distance with a woman going out with her child, who from their confidence with their walk implies they're, and she's married, respectable, not having to make her own living, whereas the woman in the foreground is having to make her own way in the world. And that's the issue the artist wants to address.
So你可以看得到他给这个画商看画，可是那画商他脸上的表情呢好像不是太喜欢，有很有可能认为说这幅画呢这个艺术家没有名，可能要说他要把他拒绝，要把他赶出去，请他再去找别人。所以呢这个艺术家穿黑衣服的这个孤儿艺术家呢，他呢跟背景呢你可以看得到有一个女性，然后带着他的小孩子出去走出去，然后他是非常一个很强烈的对比，因为带着小孩子走出门，可能这个因为比较暗一点看不太清楚，因为她是一个结婚的女孩子，然后她有钱，她可能去那边去买画，但是这个可怜的孤儿而且是艺术家呢，她可能呢一幅画都卖不出去，而且晚上还要睡在那个桥下。
Often it's quite temptingfor us to actually read these paintings as being reflections of actual social situations. And some people have thought, oh, poor Mary Osborne, she was a struggling artist herself. In fact, she was very successful. She made a lot of money through her works. She was patronised by Queen Victoria and did very well. So we mustn't you know, look at these paintings as being somehow indicative of how people...live their lives.
虽然呢，这个画面呢所讨论的是女性艺术家很悲惨的那个职业生涯，但是呢，我们要向大家提醒呢，这位艺术家 Mary Osborne， 她是在当时呢是一个非常成功的艺术家，而且呢，她不但很成功，连英国女王维多利亚女王呢都有收藏她的作品，而且是她的是她最大的赞助人之一。所以呢，你不能说看到绘画就想说这个艺术家的生活就是这个样子。其实他是在反映一个社会的情况，跟着他自己他本身的生活呢是中间是有很大的差别的。
Should we look at another painting?
Yes.
Would you like to look at past and present?
Yes. 所以我们接下来呢要去看的是三幅作品，是叫做过去与现在。
This is another triptych like the Hicks painting, three paintings, and it shows, it's called past and present. This is the past.And this is the present. And again, it's an artist trying to almost do a painter novel.
然后我们现在看到的这三幅画呢，也是像我们刚才刚看到的那个女性的任务，是三幅作品所组成的。然后这个画的那个主题叫做过去与现在，所以呢，这个是过去。然后这两幅呢是现在，没有未来，只有过去跟现在。然后有点像那个维多利亚的那个小说故事一样。
And the painting is really about the collapse of the family unit through the parents' behavior.
所以呢，这幅画呢是讲说整个家庭是怎么样子崩溃的，是因为呢他们父母亲的那个行为所造成家庭的崩溃。
So in the first scene, in the past scene, you have the woman lying on the floor, a man screwing up a letter, and the implication is he's discovered a letter from her lover. She's been unfaithful, she's having an affair, and he has perhaps with his fist beaten her.
然后呢，这幅画里面这个太太呢，她躺在地上，然后呢，这个男的呢，他手上拿着一封信，而且那个另外一个手呢，就是那个手掌握得很紧，那很可能这个就是。这封信呢是这个太太的情人写给他的，代表说这个太太呢她有外遇，然后呢那个外遇那个她的情人呢写了信给她，结果被丈夫发现，所以丈夫很生气，有可能还打了这个太太。
You'll see the woman has a bangle around her arm in the shape of a snake. That relates to Eve and the Garden of Eden.
然后她手上所戴着这个手环呢，上面呢，那形状呢有点像蛇一样。那蛇呢，就是在基督教里面，在那个 伊甸园里面呢，就是引诱男的跟女的吃禁果的那个蛇。
In the center of the composition, there's an apple. The apple is rotten here, so implying again Eve and the temptation and the fall. But the knife through it seems to go straight to the man's heart.
然后桌子上呢有半片苹果，地上还有半个苹果，所以苹果也是在那个伊甸园里面是那个吃苹果，然后那个被逐出天堂。但是如果你看这个切一半的苹果，苹果的那个刀子呢是面对的这个先生，然后下面的一半是在地上。
So this tells you what might happen to the man in the future. But the idea is the real victims are the children. They have behaved irresponsibly.Various ways. The children are creating a house of cards, but the cards are collapsing. So the implication is the whole family unit is falling apart.
然后等一下我们会告诉你说这个男的他最后的命运会怎么样。但是最大的受害者呢是这两个小孩子，因为这两个小孩子你可以看得到，他们那时候正在玩，正在叠那个牌子。但是那个牌子一叠起来，你看可以看牌子已经摊下来了。
And this brings us on to.The following scenes, which are set exactly the same moment, we can tell that because of the moon. So we have the two daughters grown up in a sort of modest bedroom. So the idea they've fallen on hard times, and the implication is both parents are dead. The father's had a stroke. The mother's not dead. She's been cast out of the home. So they are looking out at the moon, missing their parents.
Yes. So we 接下来这两幕呢，其实是在同一个时间发生的。我们怎么知道呢？你看这个月亮的形状，两个月亮呢都是在同一个形状，可能在同一个晚上发生的。然后这幅画所看到的呢，是刚才左边的这一对这一对小女孩，但是呢，这是他们已经长大了，而且你可以跟他们以前住的房子做比较。以前这房子非常的豪华，现在他们住的地方呢，非常非常的简陋，而且呢，他已经代表说他们可能已经他们的父亲已经因为那个中风，然后已经过世了，所以他们两个呢，而且母亲呢已经被逐出家门，所以他们两个已经成为孤儿了。
And then at the same moment, you have the mother with her illegitimate child looking at the moon, but she's underneath the arches by Waterloo Bridge.
想表达就是希望艺术呢也可以像音乐这样子呢，可以达成非常和谐，然后可以让大家让大家可以欣赏，而且可以享受。
So it's quite a modern painting, and it's putting forward the idea of synesthesia, that the arts all correspond and interrelate with one another. So painting, it's like music, so it's about touch, it's about sight, it's about sound.
所以呢，这个艺术家呢，他希望表达并不是只有视觉方面的，他还希望把透过这个绘画，把听觉、把触觉、把不同的感觉呢，全部都融入在这个绘画里面。那个这个英文叫做 synesthesia， 就是不同的触觉可以在同时发生。所以呢，他想透过这样子的构图，让你可以看到绘画，还可以听到声音。
But it's also it's a painting which works on different levels and registers. So in the public level, it's about sort of new art.Beauty, youth. On a personal level, it's about the artist's relationship with many young women. Burne Jones was an artist who was very susceptible to female beauty, but also he had these very intimate, sort of soul-like relationships with women who often have a higher social class than he was.
所以这幅画呢，在对大众来讲呢，看到的是一群很漂亮的女孩子，但是对艺术家本身来讲呢，还有一个个人的原因，因为呢，他自己本身有在历史上就有很多很多不同的女朋友，然后这些女朋友呢都是在社会上呢都是很有身份的，有些呢她的身份，这些女性的身份甚至比她的身份更加的高一等。
And he used a lot of these female friends as models for the figures descending the stairs. So his daughter is there, Margaret, in the centre. He was very close to his daughter. At the bottom left is Frances Graham, who was a woman he knew since she was a child. And as she grew up to become a successful society hostess, Burne Jones remained obsessed with her. Of course, he couldn't fulfil this passion's desire, but he wrote a lot to her. She visited him. They became very, very good, intimate friends, but in a sense was able to sublimate that desire and transform it into art. Yeah.
所以在这里面呢，其实他用了很多他生命中的女人。Which one is his daughter?
I'm putting the one in the center, in the middle.
In the middle, oh yeah. 所以站在最中间的那个女性呢 ，so she's holding a violin.
Yes.
Okay. 那拿着那个小提琴的这个中间的这个是她的女儿。然后在最下面的
the Francis Graham is the bottom
with the、
yes.
with the horn.
Yes.
然后拿着那个小号的左边的，然后带着那个常春藤的那个法冠的，这个是她一个她从。这个女孩子呢，是她很小的时候，艺术家就已经认识她了，看着她长大的。然后他们是很好的朋友，虽然说他们不是男女朋友之间的关系，但是艺术家对她一直非常的仰慕，而且他们之间交往非常的频繁。所以呢，这是也是她生命中非常重要的一个女性。然后她也请她来为她来做模特。
Another one of the models was Mary Gladstone, who was the daughter of William Gladstone, the Prime Minister.
Yes.
Another one was May Morris, William Morris's daughter. These were all independent women. May Morris had her own business. Mary Gladstone was very intelligent. So these were sort of new women, women who were establishing their own careers. They were successful in society. So they completely contradict the earlier image we looked at as the sort of submissive woman in the home.、Mm-hmm.
然后呢，在这里面呢，还有其他的女性的角色呢。其中有一位是那个Mary Gladstone，
yeah，
Mary Gladstone， 她是英国首相格拉斯登首相的女儿。但是呢，她不是因为只是首相的女儿，她自己有本身有很成功的事业。然后呢，另外一个女性呢，她是那个William Morris's daughter， 威廉莫里斯是一个英国很重要的一个艺术家，他的女儿，然后他也在画在这个画里面。然后这个女性呢，她自己本身呢也是在事业上也非常的成功。所以呢，我们现在所看到的这一群女性呢，她们所代表的不仅仅是美，还有她们自己本身在社会上的地位，她们有自己创下自己的事业，有自己的未来的对他们的生命已经掌握到自己的生命了，而不像我们一刚开始所讲的女性呢，全部都是依赖着男性，他们没有自己的地位，所以这个跟一刚开始我们所讲的这个女性的角色呢，是相当不同的。
So you can see in these paintings we've been looking at how the many different views of Victorian womanhood they project.、
Mm-hmm.
Some you might say is rather negative from a contemporary point of view. Others put forward a more sort of liberating ideal. But just to show that this is a time in British society when women were beginning to break away from the home and trying to establish a role for them in society, themselves in society at large.
Yeah. 所以我们刚才看得到的呢，在女性呢，维多利亚时代的女性所扮演的不同的角色，有些是非常温柔顺从的角色，但是呢，还有的是开始要解放，然后从那个他们原来所固定的角色里面呢。跳出来，所以呢，这我也象征了在当时维多利亚时代女性她们所的想法，就是她是一个时代是在从一个非常改变非常巨大的时代，从古以前对女性的要求到女性自己做提出自己的要求。
So, thank you so much for giving us the tour, and I hope that.You will be able to give us more tour in the future.
It's a pleasure.
我说很谢谢Alison 呢，Smith 为我们大家做这个讲解，然后希望呢大家有机会呢可以到那个 Tate 来参观，然后也可以直接亲自的看到这些作品，然后希望有一天呢Alison Smith 也可以替我们做更多的讲解，谢谢。